Both teams have played seven games this year. Both teams are 5-2 on the season. Slauson against 5 to begin the game. Opening tap, and here we go. The Furman Paladins with their opening possession of the game, coming off a great 74-70 double overtime win on a Tuesday at High Point. They go inside to Bothwell, and he scores the game's first two. Time now for the starting lineups, and who else should we look out for here today, Rich?
Yeah, I think it's obviously going to be number 12, John Meeks, and he's the guy for the Cougars that leads the team in scoring, and the senior, he's going to be the guy that Coach Kelsey relies on heavily in this game.
And John Meeks scores the first two for Charleston, and now the lineup for Furman.
Well, obviously, you can't look at this lineup without somebody like Mike Bothwell. We've seen what he's been able to do throughout his career, and now leading the team with 17 points per game.
Marcus Foster strong on that three. Rebound by Charleston. Here comes Rain Smith. Smith having a fantastic freshman season so far. Out to Meeks, who scored earlier. Now takes a three, and down it goes for John Meeks, shooting 39% from downtown this year.
As we just talked about, this is going to be the guy that Pat Kelsey leans on. He's the guy that has to be a leader for this team, and you can see how effective he can be beyond the arc.
Slauson, that's a three. Book it for Jalen Slauson. You talked about him in the open, Richmond. He can shoot it from outside.
He's a three-level scorer. He can go anywhere on the court. And if he can improve his three-point shooting, again, he's going to catch a lot of attention from NBA scouts.
Tie game at 5. This appeared to be a good game on paper, and so far it's lived up to the billing in the first couple of minutes. Tied at 5 here in the first half of play. Underwood stopped, tough shot, blocked out of bounds and rejected by Slauson. It'll stay with Charleston underneath. Pat Kelsey is the head coach of Charleston, came over from Winthrop, where he was last year's Big South Conference Coach of the Year.
And as we see, big substitution, and this is what Pat Kelsey does. Unit by unit, he did this at Winthrop, and he's continuing here at College of Charleston.
Miscommunication between a couple of Cougars. That's out of bounds. First turnover on the College of Charleston as they go back the other way to Furman. And checking into the game, Charles Lampton for College of Charleston. And Furman back on the attack. Tie game at 5, almost 2 minutes gone by in the opening half of play. Here's Slauson, looks for the backdoor bounce pass and knocked away out of bounds off of Charleston. Stays with Furman, 15 to shoot. The head coach of Furman is Bob Ritchie in his fifth season, and he is a guy that really calls this place home. He went to college at North Greenville. His wife is from this area, and now he's in his fifth season. And Richmond, he's got a good thing going here at Furman.
Oh, he definitely does, and he learned from one of the better coaches in all of college basketball, and that's Barclay Radebaugh down at Charleston Southern, where he got his start, and then eventually, obviously, assistant under Nico Medved, and then taking over as head coach here at Furman. And Timmons Arena is a great environment for college basketball.
Two threes missed on the same possession by Furman. Charleston ball, and they throw it away. Second turnover on Charleston here in the early going.
And they seem a little bit out of sorts right now. Great defensive pressure by Furman, and you can tell the energy that Bob Ritchie wants his team to have. It's paying off right now, because Pat Kelsey's Cougars right now, they seem a little rattled on the offensive side.
Here's Bothwell, scored the game's first points of the game, leans inside, draws the contact, he's fouled, and he will head to the line and shoot two.
He's so effective in just being able to penetrate, and just the strength that he has is just one of the key attributes for Mike Bothwell.
Let's take a look at the series history. These two teams used to be in the same conference at the SoCon, not anymore. 85th all-time meeting, and Richmond, it doesn't get any tighter than that. Tied at 42 apiece.
Yes, and it's a shame that they don't get to play every single year now that they're in separate conferences, but this is one of those storied rivalries in the Southern Conference. And remember, the Southern Conference has such rich history in college basketball.
And as you see, Charleston has won 13 of the last 15 meetings in this series. Bothwell, one of two. Fight for the rebound, offensively taken by Slauson. Here's Hunter, that's a three. Fight for the rebound, still loose, and saved into the hands of Conley Garrison. Now to Slauson. Contact, no call, they play on. Rebound by Lampton for Charleston.
And I think that's why Lampton checked in, because of his size at 6'11", to be able to go up against Slauson. And Slauson not happy with being called for the foul there.
He just got called for the foul, his first. So at the line is Charles Lampton, 6'11 junior, big guy off the bench from Roanoke, Texas. A junior college transfer from Dawson Community College, Montana.
And he's only had limited minutes this season. He's averaging about 13 minutes per game right now. But he has had some starts this season also for Pat Kelsey.
Yeah, it looked like Slauson got him on the wrist. Lampton did not score, played 10 minutes on Tuesday in the win against Tulane. And he goes 0 for 2 at the stripe, rebound by Furman. Furman in the lead by one here at home, 6-5. Here's a shot for three by Bothwell, and it goes in from the corner. Mike Bothwell has six of the team's nine first half points.
And if there's an offense that Bob Ritchie wants this team to run, that's their transition offense, and great job finding Bothwell in the corner.
Another turnover by the CFC. Here's Alex Hunter. He's a sharp shooter from outside and a senior this year as well. Bothwell against Burnham. Series of moves, fadeaway jumper goes in, and Mike Bothwell has had a game here in the first half, 8 of the team's 11 points.
When all else fails, just give it to Bothwell. You can tell that he is in the zone right now.
Five. Strong gets his own tip and puts it in. Babacar Fye, his first 2 points of the game. Hunter hits a three. Alex Hunter shooting 48% from downtown this year. Makes it a 14-7 lead. Timeout taken by Charleston. 15:55 to go in the first. And Furman doubling up on Charleston, 14-7. Back here at the Timmons Arena, inside 16 minutes to go in the first half. Furman leads Charleston 14-7. Brock Bowling, Richmond Weaver with you. And how about the Furman win on Tuesday night? Double overtime on the road. Furman wins by four.
Hey, and this is one of those games where Furman probably shouldn't have even won that game, but it was one of those games that Bob Ritchie talks about, that in his past 5 years, just the defensive effort and the gut and the grit to be able to win that game is memorable to him. And thinking that there in the double overtime win, Furman scored the first 6 points in double overtime and then held High Point without a field goal for the first 4.5 minutes of that double overtime win.
Yeah, I talked to the head coach Bob Ritchie about that win, and Bob Ritchie said that win was a top 10 most favorite win for him in his 5 years at Furman, just the way his team won in a hostile environment. He said he trusted his team's defense down the stretch to get the win, and he said he liked the team's grit, as you mentioned earlier. A lot of grit in that team on Tuesday night to get the win on the road against High Point, as Underwood goes inside and scores a two. Demetrius Underwood, his first 2 points of the game for Charleston, quiets the crowd for a moment. Furman by five, 4.5 minutes gone by in the first. Slauson lost the ball, got it back. Garrison, Heen, that's a three, and way short, caught in midair by Underwood. Here come the Cougars, clad in maroon. Underwood, Fye, and back to Underwood to run the offense of the point. Strong drive inside. Underwood, Meeks, hits a two. He has seven of the team's 11 points so far. For the Cougars, clad in maroon, backdoor bounce pass, turnover on Furman, his first of the game. Here comes Fye. Stops in the lane, stops on a dime, and throws it out of bounds. Turnover on Charleston, it's fourth in the game.
Yeah, and I think that could actually have been called for a travel there as well. So Furman gets the ball either way.
A Let's take a look at our keys to the game, brought to you by Greenville Heritage Federal Credit Union. Rich, what do you have tonight?
Well, I think for Charleston, it's obviously what they want to do under Pat Kelsey his whole career. They want to run. They want to set that pace offensively. And then also, you know, on defense, they can't just get in a comfort zone defensively because Furman is going to attack at all times. And for Furman, you can't get in that running game against College of Charleston because you got to make sure that you're in your own game attacking the basket and have a lot of that transition defense because College of Charleston's going to run quite a bit.
Marcus Foster drives inside. He lays it in for two. As the lead is five for Furman, here's Underwood in the lane. Almost lost it. Meeks. Loose ball, fought for. It's a tie-up, and the possession arrow stays with College of Charleston. Now, Furman very active on defense early on.
Big time, and even some opportunities where you're having some help defense. There you see Conley Garrison coming in there for a double team to help knock the ball away. And those are the type of plays that Bob Ritchie loves to see from his team. Can you have opportunities where you're getting some extra possessions, steal some extra possessions? Because those things can add up in the game, obviously.
Meeks against Foster, tried the little swing through move, and Foster knocked it away and out of bounds. And these are two of the better rebounding teams you'll see in the country, especially for mid-major schools. At Charleston Southern averages 42.9 rebounds a game. That leads the Colonial Athletic Association. And Furman, not too shabby, 38.3 rebounds per game. And both coaches said before the game, it's probably going to come down to rebounding in this game. As Meeks fires up a three, score it, and he's fouled. He'll head to the line for a potential four-point play.
That's how dangerous John Meeks is. He's so crafty in getting his shot off as a left-handed player. He can actually be a little bit challenged for defenses because you're not used to a guy shooting left-handed, and that can throw some of these players off just how you play defensively. And obviously right there, just not a smart play from Marcus Foster picking up that foul.
Four-point play. He averages 14 points a game. Richmond, he has 11 already in the first half. He has 11 of the team's 15. It's a one-point game as Furman leads it 16-15. Foster against Meeks. Foster backing in. Scoop shot. Off the mark. Rebound Meeks for Charleston. And the Cougars want to push. Meeks. Here's Ben Burnham. Good ball movement. Famir Ali in there. Here's Rain Smith. And the freshman puts in a three. He's having an outstanding freshman year. He averages 14 points a game. That's his first points of the night.
And it's interesting to see that two of their best shooters are both left-handed shooters. And Rain Smith, a true freshman from Australia, just one of the best shooters that you're seeing right now, especially in the Colonial Athletic Association.
Foster, Euro step, lays it in. Beautiful step through by Marcus Foster, 6'4", redshirt sophomore from Atlanta, Georgia. Tie game at 18. Charleston was down early, 14-7, had to take a quick timeout. And the Cougars have gotten right back into the game. Tie game at 18, give inside to Meeks. Here's Ali, fires up a three, hits the side of the backboard, controlled by Garrison. Here comes Hunter. The trailer Heen, blocking foul called on Rain Smith. Richmond, what do you make of this pace in the early going?
Fast. That's one word, right? Very fast. But that's what College of Charleston wants. That's what Pat Kelsey wants. Again, this team is averaging over 80 possessions per game. So you know that Pat Kelsey wants to continue to do that because it puts defenses in some conflict in terms of can you have that transition defense? And that's what we talked about. Bob Ritchie's team has to be able to have transition defense and get back. And a lot of times when you don't, it's not necessarily leading to layups. It's leading to three-point shots because of the way they move the ball.
Hey, you see that? 82.5 possessions per game. That's a lot of touches of the basketball. They try to slip it inside to Heen. Back out to Pegues, the freshman. Missing the three. Rebound by another freshman, Williams. His shot is blocked and controlled by Charleston. Ali. Horton out of five down low. Horton on the drive, finds Tucker. Good perimeter passing game by Charleston. Good perimeter D by Furman. Shot clock inside of 10. Horton. Now to Ali. Five to shoot. Ali, tough shot. And an over-the-back foul called on Charleston as we go to a break. Timeout taken. 11:47 to go here in the first half. Tied at 18 here on ESPN+. Back here in Greenville, South Carolina, the coach of Charleston is Pat Kelsey. In his first season, had a great run at Winthrop University in the Big South, fifth all-time winningest coach in the conference's history. Richmond, he averaged over 20 wins a season. That's pretty darn good.
Oh, it's amazing what he's been able to do. And just from a mid-major standpoint, not only the number of wins, but he could wreak havoc in terms of NCAA tournament opportunities. And you know, obviously beating some of the high major type of programs. And this Pat Kelsey's teams are somebody you don't want to meet up in the NCAA tournament.
He was the coach at Winthrop for nine seasons, had a good run there. I asked him what he found most attractive about the College of Charleston job. He said it was a great opportunity to do great things. And he says it's a great area to recruit to. Obviously a beautiful city, great place to live. And he says it has a great academic reputation. And it has great facilities, and he made the move, and he's happy to be there at Charleston. So here comes Furman, tie game at 18. Furman get out to a fast start, 14-7. Charleston responded, and now we're tied up, and a reach-in foul called on Brendan Tucker on the perimeter, and that's his first.
And this is what's going to be interesting to see as the game is starting to develop now. What the refs are going to allow in terms of hand checking, in terms of positioning, and how much you're going to be able to get away with. And the players are going to have to obviously adjust based on fouls that are being called or not being called.
Here's Garrison over to Foster, eight to shoot. Five of the shot clock, Slauson sees it, rises, fires, and hits a three. Jalen Slauson is sixth point of the game, his second tray, and Furman back in the lead by three.
Furman had been hot from the beyond the arc earlier in the game, cooled off a little bit, but nice job by Slauson recognizing a way to beat that zone there from the Cougars.
Underwood stopped into Meeks' hands. That's a long three from NBA range, and down it goes again. Meeks with his third three of the game, 14 points, right at his average here tonight.
I think his heels were on the logo there, so it was NBA.
Tie game at 21. We've had an exciting 10 minutes so far, and still 30 more to go. Bad pass from Slauson. He thought Foster was going to zig. Instead, he zagged. Turnover on Furman. It's second.
And these are still some of the early turnovers that you see in the season, only seven games into the season. And guys will get better in terms of the communication and understand, you know, some of the rotations in terms of players out there and how they become comfortable with each unit that's out there.
Last year, College of Charleston went 9-10 overall, 6-4 in the Colonial. Had nine games canceled due to the COVID-19 pandemic. That season last year affected everybody in college basketball. Lots of postponements, cancellations, you name it, it happened. There's a shot blocked by Slauson and taken by Slauson. Here comes Furman, tie game at 21. Foster on the drive, lays it up and misses. Had the angle, just didn't make the shots. Rebound Charleston. Farrar into the game, strong drive, banks it in.
Farrar definitely has some strength in being able to power that up off the backboard and in.
And the Cougars back in the lead by two. Here's Alex Williams, just passed the ball off. A freshman and a steal by Farrar. Trying to race down the court, ahead of the pack, goes on the other side and lays it in. Third turnover on Furman. Farrar, back-to-back buckets, and Charleston has its biggest lead of four. Bothwell splits the defense. Out to Foster. Foster stopped. Here's Bothwell. He's been very active here in the first half. 8 points already. Fadeaway jump shot. Rims out. Rebound Meeks for Charleston as he pushes the pace up the floor. All the way inside, and they call charging on Meeks. That's his second foul of the game, and they go back the other way.
And for Pat Kelsey, that's what you do not want to see, is Meeks picking up his second foul and have to probably sit down for a few minutes. As you can see here, just a little bit out of control for Meeks, and I think that's why he got the call, because Foster, he was relatively moving as well, but Meeks just seemed to be out of control.
So the second foul on Meeks, he'll come out of the game. He's in foul trouble. They want to save him for later in the game. As Furman back on offense, down four, 25-21. Garrison, that's a three. Book it for Conley Garrison, a Division II transfer for this team from Drury University. He hails from Boulevard, Missouri.
That stops the 7-0 run from the Cougars there, and that was a much needed basket for Furman.
Burnham into the lane, lost it. And a reach in foul called on Charleston. Turnover on Charleston, it's fifth. And the foul's on Burnham. That's his first.
Seems it might be getting a little chippy out there.
A little bit.
Yes, a little bit. I don't think Burnham was too happy. Neither was Bothwell there. They both were fighting for that ball.
And that'll be free throws coming up here for Furman. 17 fouls at the 8:21 mark here in the first.
Advantage Furman, obviously, from that standpoint.
So Richmond in a game of pace in this game, guys getting up and down the floor. Who do you think has the advantage? Which team has the advantage in that category?
Well, typically it's going to be College of Charleston because they're used to it, and especially from an aspect of, you know, game shape and being able from an endurance standpoint. Now, Furman, it also depends on how deep they can go on their bench, and right now they've been able to utilize their bench to be able to make sure they're resting these guys in these possessions. And I think there was actually a walk right there by Burnham before all of this happened, and you can see a little frustration between both of them there.
So here's Mike Bothwell at the line. He has 8 points, excellent free throw shooter, 1-1 free throw, and it crawls off. Rebound by Charleston. Charleston by one, Smith. Out to Horton. Smith on the drive, into the lane, and a pushing foul, they say. It's on Furman. Paladins wanted a walking violation. They don't get it. Foul's on Bothwell. That's his first.
So the fans obviously think that the walk came before the foul, but the ref called that the walk was caused by the foul.
So in other words, the foul came first.
Yes. Yeah. I don't think the fans believe that, though.
Burnham outside. Horton making a Tucker, rather. That's a three for Brendan Tucker, shooting 57% from downtown this year. He's now 17 of 29 for the season.
And Brock, you and I were talking about him earlier. He's actually one of the NCAA leaders in three-point field goal percentage this year.
Bothwell wanted a foul, so did Coach Bob Ritchie, and neither one gets the call. Shot for three goes in by Rain Smith, and he reigns in his second three of the night.
And he shot that one so fast, he shot off his shoe as well and had to put that back on. The way he can get his shot off is so fast, makes him so dangerous.
And all of a sudden, Charleston down 7 at one point, 14-7, now in the lead by 7, 31-24. Shot clock inside of 10. Bothwell against Smith. Leans inside, lays it in.
And that was actually really good defense by Smith there. That's just Mike Bothwell making a better play.
There's Rain Smith. He thought about it from deep. Elected not to take that shot that time. Here's Tucker driving. Tough shot. Rebound snagged out of the air by Alex Hunter for Furman. They slip it inside to Heen. misses the shot. Rebound Charleston, they play on. Famir Ali into the lane. Lost it, got it back. Tucker's three. Rebound skied four by Slauson, and he's fouled at the backcourt. Foul on Charleston as we get a timeout on the court. 6:22 to go in the opening half. Rain Smith reigning in his second three of the night. It's Charleston on the road, leading it by five here on ESPN Plus. Back here in Greenville and Richmond, how about the sharp shooting from outside by the Cougars here in the first half?
Oh, you look over at Furman, though, and they're 5 of 12, so you're thinking, that's a good shooting night. Well, wait a second. Charleston says, how about 6 of 8, 75% in the first half, and I think that's the difference in the game right now. They are on fire beyond the arc.
Third in the Colonial at 36.4% this season. 6 of 8 so far tonight, 75%. Shooting 75% from three, 60% overall from the field, 12 out of 20.
And you would imagine that there is going to be an aspect playing on the road that you'll probably cool off at some point, and that typically is what happened. But right now, Pat Kelsey's team, they're riding high on their hot shooting.
Jalen Slauson at the line has 2 3-pointers in this game, 6 points of the night, make it 7 as he makes the free throw. And Coach Ritchie said before the season started, Slauson, he has really made huge strides in his game from a statistical standpoint. He's really developed as a player, developed his skills, knocks down both free throws, give him 8 points on the night. And the lead is down to 3 for the CFC. And a steal. Momentarily, yes, a steal by the Paladins. 6 turnovers on Charleston. Slauson fakes the 3. Hard drive inside, and a blocking foul called on Underwood for Charleston. And Slauson will head to the line again.
That's one of the reasons why I love Slauson's game, is that he is so quick with the first step and then being able to get to the basket so fast. It only takes 1 or 2 steps for him to get to the basket. And as you can see, what he's been able to do, just not only for Furman leading the team, but also leads the Southern Conference in all 3 categories, rebounds, blocks, and steals per game.
8.5 rebounds, 2.5 blocks, 2.3 steals per game. Very well-rounded player, according to head coach Bob Ritchie. Slauson this year averaging 15 points per game. Goes 1 of 2 on that trip. Slauson has 9. Charleston's lead is down to 2. Farrar, high arcing 3. Loose ball picked up by Farrar, got his own miss and lays it in.
Farrar went up strong on that and almost dunked it there. Nice job by Farrar to be able to follow up his miss and finish strong.
Almost a steal by Horton. Bothwell got away from him. Garrison. Behind the back, stops, stumbles, loose ball, tie up. And the arrow, I think it stays with Furman. It's tough to see the arrow from this perch.
It is, yes.
So 13 to shoot. Bothwell to inbound. Finds Garrison, the Division II transfer, into Slauson's hands now. Slauson against Farrar. The quick turnaround, crawls off the rim, and the rebound by Meeks for the CFC. Farrar against Slauson, this is going to be a good matchup the rest of the game. Deflection out of bounds off of Bothwell, stays with Charleston, 17 to shoot.
And that was great defense there by Slauson. As you can see, moving his feet and even cutting off the baseline by one of the key things that you want to do to cut off the baseline. You actually step out of bounds, and that allows that defender nowhere to go.
Eight to shoot. Underwood, Tucker. Tucker with 5. Down the lane with 3. Needs help, and he misses the bank shot. Rebound by Slauson for Furman. Here comes J.P. Pegues.
He got no help off the backboard there, because that was a nice move to be able to finish before the shot clock went off.
Slauson again. They've called his number a lot here in the last couple of minutes. Leans inside, goes left hand, and scores! Oh, what a play! 11 points for Slauson.
Again, great defense again there, just moving his feet.
Charleston by two. Underwood into the lane, lost it, turns it over, out of bounds to Furman. Seven turnovers on Charleston as they go back the other way. And one thing about this arena, Richmond, it's a great arena. It's a much better arena when there are fans in here like tonight and this season compared to a year ago due to the pandemic.
How exciting is it to have fans? You can feel the electricity here because Timmins Arena is a great arena and they're doing some great things in terms of upgrading, doing some renovations. But even right now, fans can come and enjoy some great basketball. And Furman needs those fans in here. So it's great to see everybody filling this place up.
Garrison missing the three. Offensive rebound, Furman. Shot clock resets to 20. And those cardboard cutout fans from a year ago, not quite the same.
They weren't as active as some of these fans. And you can see some of these fans really letting the refs know their displeasure at times.
And a moving screen on Furman. Goes back the other way. Timeout taken on the court. 3:46 to go until halftime. Charleston on the road leads it by two. The beautiful Timmins Arena. Richmond, it's already a great facility, a great arena, very beautiful. It's about to get better.
It really is, and I know Coach Bob Ritchie is very excited about that through the leadership of Athletic Director Jason Donnelly and what he's been able to do coming in from Villanova and really emphasizing it's time for some upgrades to improve the facilities, to be able to obviously attract some of the best talent that you can to this university. So this is going to be one of the top places in the Southern Conference when the renovations are done.
Already a beautiful facility, about to improve and get even more beautiful. The Timmins Arena on the campus of Furman University here in Greenville, South Carolina. All right, so Richmond, Charleston got out to a slow start, then exploded and came back. Now it's Furman down by two, trying to get over the hump. What needs to happen?
I think just the team's settling down right now, and I think you can see that defensive pressure from Furman and being able to just slow the offensive firepower of Charleston. But obviously right there, nice reverse layup there by Fine.
Yeah, his fourth point of the game, his second basket, acrobatic play. Coach Kelsey calls him one of the smartest freshmen he's ever coached. It's Charleston by four. Here's Hunter trying to direct traffic into Pegues' hands. Slauson, that's a three. Rebound on the weak side by Burnham. Correction, it's John Meeks who's back into the game. Yeah, two quick fouls in the early going. Now he's back in after a rest on the bench.
And I think Pat Kelsey knows he might be playing with a little bit of fire by having Meeks out there, but Meeks is an upperclassman. He's just better, and he's experienced. He knows how to play with two fouls.
Score the basket by Burnham, and one. Ben Burnham's first 2 points of the game. Blocking foul on Furman. And it's on Conley Garrison, and that's his first.
Yeah, let's see. I was curious if Garrison is inside or outside. Oh, no, definitely outside of the restricted area.
Yeah,
that is a very close call.
Looked like he was moving a little bit.
Agreed.
Burnham at the line, 66% free throw shooter, swishes the free throw. He has three. Charleston is 2 of 4 at the line. And all of a sudden, that two-point lead is ballooned up to 7 again for Charleston. 2:45 to go until the halftime break. Here is Furman, the preseason second-place pick of the SoCon based on the votes by both the media and the coaches' polls earlier this season. Bothwell on the drive, tries to feed it inside, turns it over. Underwood down the lane, strong drive, no, put back, rims out by Charleston, and Underwood scores inside his second basket of the game. Timeout taken by Bob Ritchie and Furman. It's a 9-point Charleston lead.
And this is all about just when you get into a situation, turnovers leading to baskets, and that's one of the key things. It's one thing to get turnovers, but can you convert those to points? And College of Charleston is one of the better teams to be able to do that because they get out so fast, especially on transition situations like that. And then being able to continue to fight for the rebounds because they're such a good rebounding team.
Bob Ritchie coaching his team. You know, the way he got into coaching, he started out in Charleston, South Carolina, not with the College of Charleston, but with Charleston Southern. He was a grad assistant, then turned into the third assistant for Barclay Radabaugh's club at Charleston Southern in Charleston, South Carolina at age 23 in 2006. 23 years old and the third assistant on a Division I team. That's pretty good.
It's very good, and I have a little bit of familiarity with that type of situation. When I was coaching, I was a young assistant coach as well, so Coach Richie and I, we've talked about a little similar paths that we've had over the years.
Out of the timeout, Furman down nine, trying to get back into the swing of things. Bothwell's three, off the mark, rebound by Burnham for Charleston. Into Famir Ali's hands, one of the guards for this team. And how about Tucker? Now to Burnham. Underwood cut off. Shot clock inside of 10. Here's Underwood. That's a three. Looked like he got bumped. No call. Out of bounds. And it goes back to Furman. And Pat Kelsey, he wants an explanation.
And I think he deserves one, because I would say he was fouled as well. He definitely got bumped.
Under 100 seconds to go here in the first half. Here's Slauson into Bothwell's hands. He's had a great first half so far as Garrison slips. Bothwell against Underwood. Well, they're letting him play here today, aren't they, Richmond? And there's a loose ball tie-up. And no, they say timeout called first before the tie-up. Timeout, Furman.
And I think that's one of the issues that a lot of these coaches and even fans have, just want some consistency. And it's, you know, how they're calling the game in one aspect, and then all of a sudden you can see, I mean, there was contact there, but no foul. But down here, there's been other times that they have called, which you thought, why would they call something like that? I mean, there's a lot of hand-checking going on right here. And you can see just, it's almost like a push. Maybe he got tripped a little bit. But even when he's down on the floor, I mean, here all of a sudden, I mean, some of this, I know they're always going to typically call the jump ball, but in all reality, these guys are getting fouled as well. You know, they just don't call it.
So the Furman Pavilions call timeout to save the possession. 8 seconds on the shot clock. Furman down nine, 40-31, and they're going to go to the monitor just to make sure there's nothing extracurricular going on on the previous play. As they go to the monitor just to review and make sure there was nothing.
And I think they might be resetting the shot clock there. I think that's what they're reviewing right now to see if it went off his knee or off his foot.
I think they're keeping it at eight.
I think so too.
Okay.
Yes.
There's Pat Kelsey, former head coach at Winthrop. And while he was at Winthrop, four Big South regular season titles, three Big South tournament titles, and of course, we talked about it earlier, 2021's Big South Coach of the Year last year. Three to shoot. Bothwell in the lane, draws contact, beats the shot clock buzzer. Loose ball, tie-up, and the arrow points to Charleston. There's contact on that play, too.
A lot of contact. That's either an offensive charge or a block there. But no call, and leads to College of Charleston getting the ball back.
Furman began this game out to a 14-7 start. Pat Kelsey called timeout. And since then, Charleston has gone on a huge run to go up nine here, coming up on 1 minute to go until the halftime break.
And this is a big possession here for Furman defensively. You definitely want to keep them from extending their lead as you get right here, right before halftime.
Offensive foul, moving screen. It's on Underwood. His second, and they go back the other way.
Yeah, definitely a hip check there. That's going to get called every single time, especially out on the top of the key, right where the refs can see everything.
And Pat Kelsey takes a timeout, and he tries to plead his case on that last play. These are two very good young basketball coaches. Richmond, two very competitive, fiery guys as their teams take battle against each other here tonight.
A lot of energy on both sidelines for these coaches.
So under a minute to play in the first half, and Furman down nine. Trying to get something going here before the halftime break. Garrison for three. Rebound saved. Then they say out of bounds off of Furman.
I think it was off of Slauson. I think he had stepped out of bounds as he was trying to save that.
So basically 9 seconds differential between the shot clock and the game clock. Charleston up by nine as Garrett Heen comes back into the game for Furman, replacing Marcus Foster. And Charleston comes up the floor with Ali, Meeks, Tucker, Burnham, and Smith. Ali down the lane, his floater crawls in for Famir Ali, his first 2 points of the game. Shot clock turned off, Furman down 11. It could hold for the last shot until the halftime intermission.
I think that's exactly what they'll do, try to get this lead under 10 going into half. So it's big possession right here offensively for Furman.
Hunter puts in a three. Alex Hunter's second three of the game. He has six. Lead is down to eight. 3 seconds to go. In the first half, Ali had it stripped. And they don't get the shot off in time. They wave it off. Does not count. Halftime is here. And the College of Charleston on the road leads it over Furman at halftime, 42-34.
And downtown, that was John Meeks, the hot shooting. Slauson comes back and he keeps Furman in this game. A big opportunity for Furman to get a win tonight.
Charleston by eight at the break. Start of the second half and we are underway. Furman with the ball first, down eight after getting out to a 7-point lead in the early going. Slauson doubled out to Hunter, open three, and down it goes for Alex Hunter, his third three of the game. He has 9 points, and the lead is down to five.
Great recognition there by Slauson to see that double team was coming, leaving Foster wide open, so get it to him.
Now Underwood, his three, well short, out of bounds, and it goes back over to Furman. And you got to wonder if Furman goes on a run here, how much can this crowd be a factor in the second half for the Paladins here on their home floor?
I think it's going to be a big opportunity for Furman to get this crowd into it, create a lot of energy. Didn't see crowds obviously last year, so this is a situation where Furman's going to need their crowd to be in this game tonight.
Garrison, Slauson into the lane, and a reach-in foul called.
That's on Meeks.
On Meeks, that's his third foul of the game.
And now that seemed to be a situation where this is what drives coaches crazy, because that didn't seem much of a foul there based on how they were allowing him to play earlier in the game. And then now to pick up the third foul on Meeks, and we saw what Meeks was able to do at the beginning of the game. He really kept Charleston in this game.
Slauson getting position inside, stumbles, regains his balance. Nice move, shot blocked by Farrar. Loose ball, fought for and taken back by Foster. Eight to shoot. Garrison, Slauson, three to shoot. Slauson in the lane, goes up strong, he's fouled. He'll hit the line and shoot two. Fouls on Farrar, his first.
Great move by Slauson, just being able to use his body, his quickness, and I think Slauson underrated, didn't really understand just how quickly Farrar could get up. And earlier in that possession, Farrar, nice block there.
Makes the first free throw. He has 12 points. In his last game on Tuesday night at High Point, in that double overtime game, he had 12 points. He had 14 rebounds. The team of Furman as a whole had 53 rebounds in that single game. He makes both. And he has 13, and the lead is down to three.
And I don't think you could have scripted it any better for Furman to come out of here in the second half.
Nice perimeter passing and then interior passing, and a reach-in foul called on the floor against Furman.
And once again, now it seems like they're calling it very tight, and And this could be, though, an advantage for Furman to slow things down. And obviously how College of Charleston wants to get out and run.
Ali Smith, sharp shooter from outside, goes inside this time. Shot clock at 10. Ali working against Garrison. Tough fadeaway jumper. Rolls in for Ali. That was not easy.
A really tough shot there.
Furman with the ball, down five. Here is Foster. And there's a blocking foul called on Ben Burnham of Charleston, and that's his second foul of the game. Now, you're right, the first half, especially the last few minutes, letting them play, start of the second half, calling it much tighter.
A little bit different action, but also I think you're seeing now Furman really trying to attack the basket. And again, what we talked about earlier, they want to try to create some opportunities of getting to the free throw line. And you can see there, Burnham just was not able to get in position and picks up the foul.
Alex Hunter to inbound, Furman down 5, 44-39 into Slauson's hands. He's been active here tonight. And officials timeout because Mike Bothwell has some blood either on his face or on the jersey. And they're going to attend to him and get him all patched up and ready to go. As they try and stop the bleeding, put some gauze in there, and he's good to go.
He's ready to go. The fighter gets back in.
He's a hockey player. He's a good old tough player.
The way they're calling it right now, though, I don't think you're going to get away with too many physical moves right now.
Bothwell to inbound, looking, needs help into the backcourt, and barely gets it inbounds to Alex Hunter, who has three threes in this game. He has 9 points and a steal by Ali. Six turnovers on Furman. Ali to Smart, lays it up and in. Osanachi Smart off the bench for two.
And Osanachi Smart looks like he could actually be playing middle linebacker.
Slauson into the lane. And reach-in foul called on Smart. And that's his first.
And I think this is the right strategy if you're Bob Ritchie. This is what you want to do. Get to the free throw line. Get College of Charleston in some conflict in terms of defense, back Slauson down. Because Slauson has the ability to do that. That's what makes him so dangerous.
Garrison down the lane. Strong move. No. Rebound ripped away by Osanachi Smart for the CFC. Here's Ali trying to create. Goes down the lane. Hanging jumper off the glass and good. He's made two difficult shots here in the second half.
Circus act for Ali right now.
And again, the lead is ballooned back up to 9 at 48-39. Slauson faking the three as he backs it on Smart. Goes over the left shoulder and scores.
Great decision by Slauson. He obviously had that three-point shot open right there, but get easy baskets, and he can do that against Smart.
Ali again, three shots, tightly contested. And Bob Ritchie looks at his bench and says, how else do you defend that? Charleston by 9 at 50-41. It was an 8-point lead at the break. And coming into the game, Garrett Heen, sophomore for Furman. How do you defend that? I mean, the guy's right in his face. He's falling away. I mean, look at that.
And he's off balance. He's,
he's off the wrong foot.
Off the wrong foot, yes. And still shooting opposite of his shoulder. And still makes it.
Slauson got the ball knocked away. They say a clean play, and they play on. No foul called. No look pass to Fye. That got to Smith. That's a three. And that's good by Rain Smith as he rains in another three. His third of the night. He has 9 points.
And he technically had four. It just didn't count right before halftime.
Charleston with his biggest lead of the game of 12 at 53-41. And a steal by Tucker. And a reach-in foul called on Heen. And that's his first. It's amazing how quickly Charleston can increase this lead in a hurry.
All of their runs have been so fast like this. You turn your head almost,
and they score 6 or 7 points so fast, and they've made 5 of their last 5 field goals. And when you can score in that type of clip, it's going to be a tough position for any opposing team.
You see the shooting numbers. Charleston shooting 63% for the game, 39% for Furman. Charleston got out to a slow start, down 14-7, and then heated up in a hurry. Ali into the lane again. No look pass. Shot for three by Tucker is missed. And the rebound by Slauson for Furman.
But right now, there's still plenty of time left in this game. You don't have to try to get in a hurry for Furman.
They call a foul there. We get a timeout on the court. College of Charleston on the road leads it by 12, 53-41 here on ESPN+. Richmond, there's just no way else to put it. Charleston Southern is shooting, shooting lights out here in this game. 61% overall, 53% on threes.
Fire. That is what College of Charleston is, considering that they're coming into this game shooting 40% from the field and 36% from beyond the arc. So it's amazing what they're doing tonight and extending it into the second half as well. And just think about right here in the second half so far, 71% in the second half to start here in the first 4.5 minutes.
And not even 40% for the season through 7 games, but 61% so far in this one. And they call a foul inside. It's on Raekwon, correction, Brendan Tucker for Charleston. That's his second foul of the game. So Furman down 12 again, 53-41, has some work to do as Hunter inbounds. They lob it inside to Slauson. Into Bothwell's hands. He had a great first half. He had 10 points. Heen, Hunter, three, rims out on him. And the rebound by Tucker for Charleston, clad in maroon. Here's Tucker down the lane. Smith wide open for three. His fourth three of the game. He has 12 points, and the lead is up to 15, the biggest of the game for Charleston.
Just pure shooting for College of Charleston right now. They're just completely in the zone, and it's not just one player. It's all 5 out on the court.
Bothwell draws the contact and the foul. He will head of the line and shoot 2. Fouls on Tucker. That's his third of the game.
And this is what you still have to do if you're Furman. Just continue to grind. Don't get caught up in thinking that you have to just rely solely on three-point plays. And that's what I like about Mike Bothwell, taking it strong to the rim right there and getting the foul, getting to the free throw line, and now you need to convert.
Bothwell makes the first free throw. He has 11 points. He was second team All-SoCon last year, preseason All-SoCon this year, and Coach Ritchie has said he's made incredible strides this year with his game. He can score at all 3 levels, brings a lot of energy to this team. And he goes 2 for 2. He has 12. Charleston's lead is down to 13. Coming up on 15 minutes to go as they trap Smith, trying to force some turnovers, trying to slow down this offensive display of shooting by Charleston here tonight.
Yeah, and I think Coach Richards looking for any opportunity to try to get them out of their offensive rhythm. But now the other side of this is just what a great rebounding team that College of Charleston is, and it paid off there, as you can see them getting the offensive rebound and scoring.
Slauson backs in on 5, tough shot, crawls off the rim, and it is saved out of bounds by Charleston. Loose ball, fought for, and Smart picks it up for Charleston. Here's Ali, Smith in rhythm of 3. Not this time, and the rebound by Slauson for Furman. Into Bothwell's hands, tight ropes the sideline, shot for 3. Weak side rebound offensively by Heen. Kept alive into Hunter's hands. Hunter lost it, turnover on Furman, it's 9th. Charleston again up 15. Ali one-on-one against Alex Hunter. Shot clock at 10. There's Smith again. Thought about it from 3. Shot clock at 6. Ali Cross courts it. Five. Three to shoot. Five. Puts it up. Got his own rebound. Into Smart Sands. Shot clock resets to 20. Under 10 to go on this possession. Here's Ali. One-on-one against Bothwell. Ali spinning, shooting, left it short, and it's caught by Foster.
Great defense by Bothwell. I think he got a
Hunter,
piece of that.
And they wave it off. Offensive foul on Hunter. He had the lob right there for Slauson, but they wave it off.
A real heady play there by the freshman, Rayan Smith for Charleston.
That's one thing that Coach Kelsey said about Rayan Smith, a pure shooter, one of the best in the nation, but it overshadows his other skills he brings to this team, and that was one skill right there, taking the charge.
It's the intangibles a lot of times that make these players so difficult if you're an opposing team, because not only are they so good on the offensive end, like Smith is, but even in those type of situations on the defensive side, just a very smart play.
Lobbed inside, steal by Furman. Hunter for three, book it. Alex Hunter is 4-3 of the game. He has 12 points and the lead is down to 12.
And if there's a guy that can get Furman back into this game from beyond the arc, that's Alex Hunter leading the team at 48% three-point shooting coming into the game.
Fouls on Foster, and that's his third of the game. So he's in foul trouble with 12:43 remaining in the game. 12-point advantage for the College of Charleston, clad in maroon. Here's Underwood driving out to Smith. That's a three. Good again by Rayan Smith, his fifth three of the game. He has 15 points. On the other side, here's Hunter, and he lost it. Out of bounds, back to the CFC. Rayan Smith, it's appropriate his first name is Rain.
Yes, it
he's
is.
He's raining threes.
And he's from Australia and actually technically from Tasmania. And right now he is the Tasmanian devil from beyond the arc for Furman, because he is putting on a show and showcasing why he's been named Freshman of the Week three times.
Yep.
In the Colonial Athletic.
Yeah, he had 22 points and six threes on Tuesday in the win against Tulane. He has 15 points right now. Coming into the game tonight, he averages shooting 45% from downtown this year. That's pretty good. In fact, it's very good.
Very good, and especially as a true freshman, he's been very consistent. And that's why a lot of times you see true freshmen, they have ups and downs. You might see an explosion, but then they'll have a couple of games where they just disappear. But he has not this season.
Burnham against Heen. Lost it. Turns it over. 10 turnovers on Charleston. Here's Heen. Hunter. And back over to Conley Garrison. Whips it inside to Heen. Lays it in.
And I think that's the offense that Bob Ritchie wants Furman to run. Transition, but back it out, and then get into your offensive set.
Meeks cross-courts it. Tucker, strong move, curls off the rim, and the rebound controlled by Garrison. Run down by Hunter, but it's out of bounds near us. Back to the CFC, timeout taken on the court. 11:30 to go here in Greenville. College of Charleston on the road leads it by 13. Back here in Greenville at the Timmons Arena, Brock Golding, Richmond Weaver with you. And Richmond, when it comes to Furman, six different players have scored tonight, but it's been mainly the three-headed monster of Mike Bothwell, Alex Hunter, Jalen Slauson, combining for 39 of the team's 48.
Yes, and obviously these are top talent level for Furman, and what Bob Ritchie needs right now is a little bit more balanced scoring. He needs a Conley Garrison to be able to contribute. He needs a Marcus Foster to really get into the game offensively as well. That's when they're the best, when they can have a situation getting guys much more involved. They had five players in double figures in that overtime, double overtime win against High Point. They need that again.
Steal by Furman. And Slauson has it. Mismatch inside against Ali. Lays it in. 17 points for Jalen Slauson. Three away from tying his career high. But the lead is down to 11 with 11 minutes to go.
That was a bounce in the house there. It was a complete mismatch. So Lawson took advantage of that.
Ten to shoot. Horton covered heavily by Hunter. Six to shoot into Meeks's hands. Shot clock at two. Meeks, step back jumper. And they say shot clock violation first. Turnover on Charleston is 12. And it goes back over to Furman. A much needed stop and turnover forced by Furman. And Bob Ritchie said before the game, one of the keys for his team would be rebounding, but how can you rebound when Charleston doesn't miss?
Exactly. That's a tough thing. And so now, over these last 10 minutes, it'll be interesting to see, will Charleston have a little bit tougher time shooting, and will Bob Ritchie look to some different type of defenses to get them out of their offensive rhythm?
Slauson can't make the shot this time. Rebound by Horton. Here comes Charleston in the lead by 11, led by 8 at the break. They whip it inside to Meeks. Back outside Horton. That's a 3. Rebound ripped away by Slauson for Furman, and the outlet pass to Hunter. Lead pass up the floor. Anderson. Garrison. Open. 3. And weak side rebound by 5 for Charleston. Ali lobs it down low to 5. He turns it over. Number 13 in the game for Charleston. Slauson. Down the baseline. Stopped. In the corner, Anderson. Williams, the freshman, thought about it. And the Paladins will run some offense up front. Hunter, into the lane, scores! 14 points for Alex Hunter. The lead is down to single digits at 9 with 9:30 to go. Timeout taken by Pat Kelsey and Charleston. 9:28 to go in the game. The hometown team, Furman Paladins, put it down to 9, 61-52 here on ESPN Plus. Back here in Greenville, South Carolina, the Timmons Arena. There's a look at the Furman Paladins, coached by Bob Ritchie. And here's a look at Bob's impact in Richmond. 3 straight 20-win seasons from 2017-18 through 2019-20. An NIT appearance, and you see the number of all SoCon players he's produced, and a winning percentage, .723.
It was absolutely fantastic. And one of the reasons why is that I think he's so good at game adjustments and able to make some decisions to change things up a little bit. Putting Joe Anderson in right now, who's only played 2 games this season so far, has allowed them a little bit of a spark, even on the defensive side, has allowed them to go on this 6-0 run here.
And Ritchie, he went to school, college at North Greenville University. His wife is from the area, and he's now coaching in Greenville at Furman. He's been here 5 years, doing a good job, and he's living the dream.
And for Furman fans, they hope he stays here. Because, as you know, these mid-major programs, the tough thing about any mid-major program, not just isolated to Furman, is that typically when you have success with a particular coach, some of the high major programs come and steal those coaches.
Demetrius Underwood at the line. Makes both. He has 6. Back up to a double-digit lead at 11. 9:11 to go in the game. Here's Furman clad in white trying to run that offense and try and get back into this game. Down 9. Backdoor pass. Hunter. Shot blocked, but he got fouled. And Hunter will head to the line and shoot 2.
Excellent pass. Great backdoor cut there. And again, that's what Furman needs to do right now. You don't have to get in a run-and-gun situation with College of Charleston. You just need to run your offense, and you can have success. A lot of overplaying there by College of Charleston, and Alex Hunter realized that and took it backdoor.
First one is good for Hunter. Give him 15 now for the game. Preseason All-SoCon this season. High-level shooter. 4 threes in the game, shooting 48% from downtown this year. This game has a lot of good shooters tonight.
Yes, it definitely does. And Alex Hunter is also a guy who's out there on the court a lot, averaging almost 36 minutes per game for Bob Ritchie.
Furman 10 of 13 at the line. It's down to a 9-point game, and now make it back up to 11 again. The basket is good by Underwood, and he's fouled. A chance for a 3-point play.
That was an explosion by Underwood. Went up very quick. I don't think even Slauson realized how fast he was going to go up there and was surprised, and then obviously even more surprised that he was called for the blocking foul as well.
So here's Underwood at the line, and Coach Pat Kelsey said before the game, this young man kind of got lost in the shuffle. He's a high D1 caliber type of player, but just kind of got lost in the mix somehow, but he was fortunate enough to find him, and he's glad he's on his team.
You can see how athletic he is on both sides of the floor.
Williams, no, missing the three. Weak side rebound by Ali for Charleston. Meeks, Underwood scored a 3-point play a moment ago. Underwood against Williams. Smith. Meeks. Traveling violation on Charleston. Turnover number 14. Back over to Furman, down 12 with 8:28 to go. And the Paladins come up the floor with Slauson, Hunter, Anderson, Garrison, and Williams. Slauson stumbles. Oh, they call a blocking foul on Underwood, and he can't believe it.
So they exchange fouls here. Neither one of them could believe that they got charged for. Called for a blocking.
His foot kind of inadvertently tripped him as he was backing in.
And it seemed like in the first half, they would have let that go. Here in the second half, not so much.
So one-on-one free throws for Jalen Slauson. Makes the first. He has 18 points. Coach Richie says he has all the tools. He can dribble, he can pass, he can shoot. Runs the floor well, good leader. He's really developed his game nicely here at Furman. This is the second one, and a reach-in foul on Charleston. And Alex Williams will go to the line for two, the double bonus.
And I think that's on Meeks as well, so that's going to be his fourth foul.
It is on Meeks, and that's his fourth. So the freshman, Alex Williams, who gets a little treatment on the sidelines for his nose. He's a freshman, 6'5". He's from Ohio. And Coach Richie said before the game, he's just a walking bucket. His ceiling is very high. He can shoot. Really likes the potential in this young man.
Well, he has what you also can't teach, and that's his size. 6'5", 205 pounds. He's a guy that's going to be a name you're going to know a lot here in the Southern Conference.
Yeah, 3 points against High Point on the road in that double overtime win on Tuesday, and goes 1-for-2 on that trip. Furman now 12 out of 17 at the line here tonight. Underwood backs in on Garrison. Good defense by Garrison and takes it away. Here's Hunter. Hunter, that's a three. Too strong. Offensive rebound by Slauson. Shot clock resets to 20. Williams driving. Contact and a late foul called. It's on Charleston. And Williams will shoot two when we come back. Timeout on the court.
And Demetrius Underwood for Pat Kelsey, just a bucket as well. Just the explosion that he's had has allowed College of Charleston continue to have a 10-point lead here in Greenville.
Here in Greenville at the Timmons Arena, Brock Bowling, Richmond Weaver with you, and Richmond, Jalen Slauson doing it again. Another double-double here tonight for the Paladins.
He's a double-double machine, and this is what makes him so attractive for not only the next level, but there is a true potential that I could see an opportunity for him in the NBA. Obviously, you could look at maybe an undrafted type of situation, but he has the athletic ability and just the size and the length that a lot of NBA scouts will like.
Yeah, he had 12 points and 14 rebounds in that double overtime win on Tuesday at High Point. The team had 53 rebounds as a whole. And now Alex Williams going to the line. One of two, his last trip up there. This one, first one, missed. Furman down 10, 7:47 to go. I missed them both. Furman now 12 of 19 at the line in this game, seven misses. Charleston in the front court, up 10. Foul away from the ball, it's on Foster. No correction, it's on Bothwell. His second. Team foul number seven, so now free throws the rest of the way for Charleston, and one of the best shooters in America, Grain Smith at the line, 87% free throw shooter. Knocks it in, he's now 15 of 17 at the line this year.
This is definitely not the guy you wanted on the free throw line. And I'm going to round him up to 88% there, Brock. So I'm going to give him that one extra percentage point for you.
Charleston by 12. Furman ball. Inside, 10 to shoot. Slauson backs in on Smart. Down to six. Slauson makes his move. Leans inside. Got fouled by Smart. And Slauson will head of the line to shoot two.
I think that's going to be called every single time. Slauson just backing down. And the arm bar by Smart. And then he doesn't release the arm bar and just put his hands up. He's still extending over. Just causing the foul. Slauson goes to the line. Now, this is where it's going to be very important for Furman. They're having some opportunities to get to the free throw line. They just have to convert.
And that one goes in. Nothing but net by Slauson. He has 19. And the lead is down to 11. Lead is down to 10. 20 points for Jalen Slauson. Ties his career high. 10-point game, under 7 to go. Ali travels. That's now 15 turnovers on Charleston in the game.
And those are the type of plays that Bob Ritchie really is needing from his team right here in the last 7 minutes of the game, because it's not about that you have to get everything all at once. It's can you steal certain possessions and limit College of Charleston getting offensive possessions.
Anderson, nowhere to go. Slauson fakes the three. Goes inside. Little pirouette, drops it in. A new career high for Jalen Slauson, 22 points, and the lead is inside of single digits. It's down to 8. Oh, and a reach-in foul called up front on Slauson, and they fouled the wrong guy, like you said earlier, Richmond. They foul Rain Smith. He's pretty much automatic from the line.
He is, and that's the last thing that you want to do. Almost bailed him out right there because it looked like he was out of control and losing the handle there. And you could say, was it the foul that caused him losing the handle or not? But it looked like the ball was about to come out prior to the foul, but the refs did not think so.
So Rain Smith goes to the line, 17 points. One of the best shooters from the line and from beyond the arc in the nation. 1-1, first one goes in.
He just has such a pure shot, just the rotation, everything. That's ideal from a shooter's perspective.
Shot number two coming up for Rain Smith. 18 points, give him 19 points in the game. Lead is back up to 10. Furman trailing, 6:16 to go. Slauson fakes the three, now goes inside. He backs in on Charles Lampton. Backs in some more. Tough fadeaway shot. Offensive rebound, Garrison, and he's fouled. And he will go to the line for a 1-1.
You can tell right now, College of Charleston's having a tough time with Lawson. He's just backing down at will. And there's an aspect you could probably even call a foul on College of Charleston as Lawson's backing down. They're just bodying him up, but the refs are allowing them to play.
At the line is Conley Garrison. Coach Bob Ritchie calls Garrison the perfect player for the Furman system. And he says he's just a shot maker, one of the toughest guys on this team. Scores his fourth point of the game. 80% free throw shooter coming into the game tonight.
He just looks like a grinder.
He does.
Just a guy that is, as almost as Bob Ritchie says, just perfect for this system, because that's one of the things that Bob Ritchie prides himself on is the grit to be able to grind through adversity. And that's what he's been able to build, that type of culture, that type of philosophy and mindset here at Furman.
Here comes full court pressure put on by Furman, and Charleston looks to break it easily. Famir Ali, point guard for the team, picked up by Anderson. In Smith's hands, 10 seconds to shoot. Smith. Meeks turns on Hunter. Inside pass to Fye, lost it. Got it back, two to shoot. Fye puts it up and banks it in at the buzzer. 6 points for Babacar Fye, and the lead is back up to 10.
And it's just been one of those nights for Charleston to be able to make a shot like that.
Hunter, mid-range jumper, goes down for Hunter. He has 18, and the lead is down to 8 again. And a near steal, and it's out of bounds off of Ali. Turnover on Charleston. It's 16th of the game.
And Joe Anderson has been a spark plug on the defensive side for Furman right now.
So Furman ball inbounding right in front of us. As a Garrison was going to inbound, and now it's going to be Mike Bothwell. So Ali goes out of the game, so does John Meeks. As Underwood back into the game along with Horton, or correction, a Tucker for Charleston.
And I think both coaches right now are trying to get their key guys a minute or two of rest, knowing that they're going to need them down the stretch right here as we're getting under 5 minutes.
Hunter, a long two, got it. 20 points for Alex Hunter. It's down to a two-possession game. Furman was down 15 at one point in this second half.
And this is what I talked about. You don't have to try to get it all just with three-pointers. To stay within your offense, you still have time. You look at it in four-minute increments as a coach, and if you can get that, then you have an opportunity of staying in this game, and that's just what Bob Rich has been able to do so far right here in this last 10 minutes.
A miss from three by Smith. Rebound, Pavlidis. Bothwell down the lane. Can't finish. Rebound by Charleston. And the Cougars want to run. Tucker. Fye. Back to Tucker. And the Cougars will run some clock. Inside, 4 minutes to go. Two possession game. Charleston in the lead by six. Underwood. Tough fadeaway. Off the mark, rebound on the deck. Now picked up by Charleston into Tucker's hands. Tucker, and he traveled. Turnover on Charleston, number 17 in the game, and we get a timeout on the floor. 3:41 to go here in Greenville. Charleston on the road, leads it by six on ESPN Plus. Back here in Greenville at the Timmons Arena, Brock Bowling, Richmond Weaver with you. Let's take a look at the upcoming schedule for Charleston. Tulane, Presbyterian at Stetson on December 16th. Game against Rhode Island on the 19th, and then at Old Dominion on December 22nd. A team that started out 5-2 this season under the guidance of first-year head coach Pat Kelsey.
And a rare home-and-home situation with Charleston Southern playing Tulane and obviously already beating them 81-77 earlier in the year.
And Furman plays at Winthrop on December 7th, then App State, at North Carolina, at Mississippi State in the SEC, and then home against Presbyterian before the Christmas break. Anderson missing the shot. Offensive rebound by Slauson. Slauson playing with four fouls, and he throws it away. Out of bounds, turnover on Furman, number 13. So Richmond, 6-point game. What does Furman need to do to try and get over this hump here in the final 3:26?
They obviously need to limit any type of opportunity for College of Charleston with Underwood running point right now. But I think offensively, I think it's all about, it's got to go through Slauson. Good things happen when you can get it down low to Slauson and even try to get him through the free throw line.
And Smith splits the defense. He drove hard to the rack. He got fouled. And he will head to the line and shoot two more.
And I think Smith said that, I don't have to just shoot from beyond the arc. I'm actually going up and going strong to the hole here. Great job by Smith. He's just showcasing again just how talented he is overall, not just as a pure shooter. He actually has some athletic ability to get to the rim as well.
He played on the under 20 2020 Australian National Championship team. Averaged 20 points and shot 49% on threes in that event. He has 20 points so far tonight. He has five threes. He's gone to the line, and he makes two more. 1 point away from tying his career high. He's only a freshman.
But he's what we call automatic.
Under three to play. Furman with the ball, down eight. Slauson against Underwood. Goes up strong, blocked from behind, but a foul called on Lampton. That's his second, stops the clock, and Slauson will shoot two.
And this is what you don't want to do if you're Pat Kelsey, is having the clock stopped and allowing an opportunity to score points. As you can see, Slauson gets hits there as he goes to the rim, and that's what I was talking about. I think these last few possessions are going to have to go through Slauson each and every time.
23 points for Slauson. New career high here tonight. Last year, he averaged 8 points and five rebounds a game in 25 games. This year, 15 points per game and eight boards a game as well. Makes both free throws, giving 24 points on the night. Charleston by six with 2:45 to go. Meeks slips it inside. Fye loses it. Turnover on Charleston. Here comes Bothwell being hounded by Ali. Anderson has it in his hands. Now to Hunter. Hunter, Conley, Garrison. Now to Slauson. Skips it over to Hunter. Shot for three. Rimming off. And the rebound controlled by Charleston and Underwood. Underwood. Fye. Shot blocked by Garrison. Underwood scores. 11 points for Underwood. Back up to an 8-point game inside 2 minutes to go.
You can see how important just extra possessions can be there, even with the nice block there by Garrison. They were
Anderson.
Able to get the offensive rebound.
Anderson scores somehow in the lane. His first points of the game. Timeout. A 30-second timeout taken by Bob Ritchie and Furman. Down to a 6-point game again.
Nice move by Anderson there. Just being able to stop on a dime there, spin, and being able to have a nice soft touch.
So a timeout taken by Bob Ritchie and Furman. And it seems like in this second half, Richmond, it gets to that 6-point deficit range, and then it just hasn't been able to get over the hump.
Yeah, and I'll be interested to see here defensively, will Bob Ritchie look to run something a little bit different, not just have a straight-up man? Will he go to some type of half-court press, you know, some type of trapping, or does he even really switch it up and go to a zone? He haven't seen really any type of zone other than maybe one other time earlier in that first half from Bob Ritchie. So it's now, right now, you're trying to disrupt College of Charleston and their offense right now. We'll see how Bob Ritchie approaches this.
Bob Ritchie got into coaching because he said he was a big Gamecock fan in South Carolina growing up. He saw Eddie Fogler coach, went to Eddie Fogler's camps as a kid, and said Eddie Fogler has the best job in the world. He gets to coach basketball and get paid for it. That's how he got into coaching, got the coaching bug. Meeks blocked. Out of bounds to Furman.
And as I had mentioned, you have an opportunity to change your defense and look at another situation. That's what they were able to do with that full court press, ultimately leading to a turnover.
And they're going to review to see if the ball was indeed out of bounds off of Charleston. We're inside of 2 minutes, so they can go to the monitor and confirm it or reverse it.
From my vantage point, I know we're far off. It did look like it was actually off of Furman. So it'll be interesting to see on this call here.
Well, Jalen Slauson, he was frustrated that they were going to go to the monitor because he wanted to get that ball in play quickly.
Yes, he sure did.
It looked like he might agree with the call.
No, they're actually staying with.
Okay.
And we'll see here.
Tough to tell.
Is that one of those situations where the call stands? Not enough video evidence to overrule that?
So Slauson will inbound. It's Slauson, Anderson, Garrison, Hunter, and Bothwell, the five of the floor for Furman, clad in white.
And here again, you've got to go through Slauson each and every time.
Slauson on the drive. Lays it in, and he's fouled. Oh, no, they say it was on the floor. Foul on the floor before the basket. He'll shoot two. No continuation there, I guess.
And I think that's one of the biggest challenges in college, that there should be a continuation. He's still in the act of shooting on that spin move there.
So Slauson at the line, he has 24 points, 13 in the second half. He will shoot two. His team is down six, a minute 27 to go.
And the leading scorer for College of Charleston, John Meeks, fouls out of the game. That's definitely a guy that Pat Kelsey would like to have out there.
First one is nothing but net from Slauson. Give him 25 for the night. 26th free throw attempted the night by Furman. This will be number 27. Misses it. Rebound by College of Charleston. Up five, a minute 22 to go. Timeout taken by Pat Kelsey and the CFC. 30-second timeout. It's been a heck of a game.
It's been a really good game. Up and down, a lot of energy from both teams. A lot of really good shooting, obviously, that we saw from College of Charleston. But Furman has been able to hang around, and that's one of the things that Bob Ritchie's team that you could always depend on is that they have that grit. They kind of grind, and even in a situation where you had College of Charleston shooting 59% in the first half, it was still within reach for Furman, and here we are now with a minute and 20 to go. Furman's only down by five. You get a defensive stop here, come down and just run your offense the way you have need to. You don't have to get in a hurry type of situation right now. There's still plenty of time. Just, you've got to get a stop right here.
Yeah, Furman started out the game up 14-7. Charleston with an explosion of a run and went up eight at the break. Been nip and tuck and back and forth here for the most part in the second half. Bob Ritchie's team at one point down 15. Now down to five. This is the closest that Furman has had Charleston here in the second half. They inbound to Underwood. He's picked up by Hunter.
And I think this is going to be Underwood and Smith. It's going to be one of the two main options they're going to be looking for right here.
Shot clock inside of 10. Ali working against Slauson. Stops on a dime. Plays it in the corner. Spotting up for three is Underwood and misses it. Rebound. Hunter's got it for Furman inside of a minute to go. Furman down two possessions. Down five. 76-71. Hunter, Bothwell. And a foul inside, I believe, on Famir Ali away from the ball. It is on Ali. That's his second. Slauson will go to the line again.
Now, that was just really good scouting by Furman, knowing that Underwood is 0 for 6 from beyond the arc on the season and allowed him to shoot that three.
First one is good by Slauson, give him 26 points on the night. It's down to a four-point game. As Ben Burnham comes back into the game for Charleston, replacing Babacar Faye. Slauson, 26 points, 15 since the halftime break. Oh, left it well short, fight for the rebound. Garrison's got it, out to Anderson, his three. Rimming off, rebound by Charleston. And about a 9-second differential between the shot clock and the game clock. And Furman is down two possessions.
Got a trap going.
Timeout taken by the Cougars. Extends it to a full timeout. Furman is 20 of 29 at the line. Nine misses so far tonight for Furman. CFC takes a timeout. Charleston up four, 29.2 to go. And what do you expect here strategy-wise from both teams?
Yeah, I think here Bob Ritchie's going to put some type of trap in place right here. And then for College of Charleston, it's going to be in Demetrius Underwood's hand or Ali, trying to see if they can actually get some two-man action and try to get Rain Smith the ball, because obviously there's a situation where if somebody's going to get fouled, they want the ball in Rain Smith's hands because of how he shoots at the free throw line.
And how much time, if you're Furman, do you allow to come off before you have to start fouling if you don't get a steal right away?
Yeah, I think pretty quickly. I think within 5 seconds or so, I think you're going to have to try to get the steal. And if you don't, then you're going to foul.
So 29.2 seconds to go. Charleston leads it by four. Charleston ball out of the timeout taken by Pat Kelsey and the Cougars. And keep in mind, Richmond, that the Cougars' last two wins have both been very close games, winning by two at Chattanooga and winning by four against Tulane at home earlier this week. Inbound to Ali, trapped on the sideline, lost it, got it back, loose ball, and a foul called. It's on Furman. That's on Bothwell, his third of the game.
Yeah, and it was actually as he was on the ground. And great trap, as I had mentioned. You knew they were going to come out and trap and had an opportunity right there to get the steal. But as Bothwell is on the ground, like rolls into Underwood, causing the foul there, right there.
So Underwood at the stripe, he has 11 points. Three above his average. He had 8 points and 7 boards in the win on Tuesday against Tulane. And he strokes in the free throw, give him 12 points on the night. Lead is back up to five, 24.5 to go.
And he's a 71% free throw shooter on the season.
Makes them both a full two-possession game. Two-possession lead here, 6 points. The lead for Charleston. Timeouts, Bob Ritchie and Furman. So 24.5 to go here. Do you necessarily need a three on this particular possession?
No, you do not. But I would expect that College of Charleston probably extend their defense out a little bit to try to force Furman to take more time off the clock before they can get into their offense. And I think here you're going to look at some type of inside-outside action, try to get it to Slauson. If he has an opportunity to get a quick two, take that, but not, he's going to have to try to kick it out to an open man to hit a three.
Both teams out to great starts this season. Furman 5-2, Charleston 5-2, led by two great young head coaches, Pat Kelsey, who played at Xavier. Bob Ritchie played right here in Greenville at North Greenville, and two guys that are really passionate about coaching this great game.
Yeah, and they both, they're energetic, but they also both have that kind of grinder mentality as well. Even Pat Kelsey, I mean, he looks like a guy that would play at Xavier and in Cincinnati. Just, you know, that type of blue-collar type of player and coach. And you see a lot of that in the teams for both respective coaches.
Bob Ritchie in his fifth season, former assistant coach at Furman for 5 years before taking over the head coaching job. And Pat Kelsey, the longtime head coach at Winthrop, who changed jobs and came over to Charleston this past spring. 20 seconds to go. Furman down six. Hunter, catch and shoot three. Got it! Full court pressure put on by Furman. It's a three-point game, 16.2 to go. And a steal by Anderson. Furman has it. Down three. Hunter for the tie. No! Rebound. Traveling the call on Charleston. And it goes back over to Furman, down three, 10.5 to go.
I think we might have a...
So Furman ball down three, 10.5 to go.
Yeah, I think they're making sure the time on the clock is correct.
So Hunter hit a three to cut the lead down to three. Then a turnover, a shot missed for three for the tie. Another turnover by Charleston. It's down to a one possession game, 78-75. Charleston by three. Furman ball, 10.5 seconds to go. What do you look for here?
Yeah, again, you saw a lot of action there. Screens, guys coming off the screen, rolling around. I think you're going to see the same things here. But you don't necessarily have to have a three. Again, if you can get an easy two, take the easy two right now.
Slauson inbound, Furman down three.
Slauson
gets it over to Garrison. 9 seconds to go. Bothwell with six, needs help. Slauson, no, they have Bothwell, puts up a three, banks it in to tie the game. 0.9 to go. Oh, what a play! Timeout taken as they go to the monitor to see how much time should be left on the clock. Mike Bothwell banks in a three with less than a second to go to tie the game. What a play.
When in doubt, get it to your leader on the team, and that is Mike Bothwell with the left hand. Just a fantastic shot. I know he didn't call bank, but we'll call it for him there.
A friendly Friday night banking hours here in Greenville, South Carolina. Furman has crawled all the way back, down 15 at one point in the second half to tie the game on a miraculous shot by Bothwell, banking it in for three off the glass to tie the game at 78. 1.2 seconds remaining, and Charleston has to go the length of the floor to try and get a shot off to win it here in Greenville.
So I think there's going to be some type of long pass here. They'll set a screen for Smith, try to get him coming off the screen, probably try to catch it about half court, and turn and shoot.
Underwood inbound, he baseballs it down the floor. It is deflected, it's caught by Garrison. We're going to overtime here in Greenville, South Carolina. Put five more minutes back on the clock. We'll take a timeout as well. End of regulation, tied at 78. Mike Bothwell, the hero at the end of regulation for Furman. Back in Greenville, South Carolina, as we go to overtime. We go to overtime, five more minutes back on the clock as Furman crawled all the way back down 15 points at one point in the second half, tying the game at the end of regulation. Lampton will jump center circle for Charleston, Slauson in the middle for Furman. Overtime tap, and here we go, another 5 minutes for these two teams to duke it out and see who's the better team here tonight. Tie game at 78. Ali on the drive, lays it in. That was too easy.
Way too easy. Bob Ritchie is definitely not happy with the defensive pressure there with Furman. Got to have a much better communication.
Bothwell, the hero a moment ago. Inside Slauson, playing with four fouls, being pushed by Lampton. Goes up and scores. 28 points for Jalen Slauson. He has really led this team here tonight.
Every offensive possession, they have to have Slauson touch the ball. It's
Underwood,
as simple as that.
Underwood now to Tucker. Back to Underwood as he backs in on Anderson. Little mismatch there. Tucker spots up for three, and it's missed. Rebound, out of bounds. Two Furman. I still can't get over that shot by Mike Bothwell. I mean, just a prayer, and it was answered.
Hey, and it was all, he didn't have anywhere to go except being a crafty left-handed guy, was able to get enough balance and make that shot.
Here's Bothwell, the hero, at the end of regulation to tie the game at 78. Slauson fakes the shot. He got bumped and tripped and fouled by Lampton, his third, and Slauson will go to the line again. And you just feel, even though it's a tie game still, momentum is on Furman's side.
Oh, it definitely is. You can feel it here in Timmins Arena as well, just how they've been able to continue to fight and fight through the last 10 minutes of the game. And I think a big piece of this is that Jonathan Meeks is not in the game anymore for College of Charleston, fouling out.
First one short by Slauson. Tie game at 80, 3:49 to go in overtime. As Lampton checks out, Farrar checks back in. Slauson shooting 72% for the year at the line, makes one of two, given 29. And Furman has a one-point lead. It's first lead since way early in the first half.
It's been a long time since Furman has been able to say they were in the lead.
Farrar, tough shot, and banks it in. He's in double figures with 10, tying his career high.
I would have to say College of Charleston has made some really difficult shots tonight. Maybe nothing like Mike Bothwell did, but a lot of tough shots.
And Slauson again, the catch, the bank shot. He has 31, and Furman back in the lead.
I sound like a broken record, but it's obvious you have to go through Slauson each and every time.
Ali, strong drive into Tucker's hands, and he lost it. And there's a foul on Rain Smith. He tripped Anderson. That's Smith's third, and free throws coming up for the Paladins.
Just great hustle play by Furman right now. A lot of communication going on the defensive side, which is allowing them to be in position. It looks like Anderson is actually might have hurt his wrist a little bit there on that foul by Smith.
So Joe Anderson will head of the line, 6 foot sophomore from Maryville, Tennessee. Comes in averaging 4 points a game. He has two in this game. He's really provided a spark for this club here off the bench tonight when the team needed it. Misses that foul shot. Furman is now 21 of 32 from the line in the game.
Yeah, he's only averaging 9 minutes per game and only played in two games this season, so this is a big opportunity for him tonight.
Well, misses both. Rebound, Charleston. Furman by one inside. 3 minutes to go here in overtime. Farrar backs in. Crawls off the rim. Rebound Slauson for Furman. Hunter. Slauson. on the drive, playing with four fouls. Goes up, had his shot blocked, and it's loose, picked up by the Cougars. Here's Underwood, spinning away from the defense, lays it up and in inside as Underwood has 15, and it's Charleston back in the lead by one. Coming up on 2 minutes to go in OT. Anderson trying to get a read on the defense, goes inside. Oh, he tried to bounce pass it to Garrison, and they say out of bounds off of Garrison, and Furman wants the officials to take a look. And they're going to look. What a game. And it's still going.
It is, and this is a barn burner of a type of game, and we expected that we would see something like this. College of Charleston had the big lead, but Furman continued to hang around. As we can see here, just they're looking at the monitor to double check, not only make sure they got the call correctly, but are from a reset perspective as well. And
yeah.
That's close. That
I think it's off, Harrison.
It would look close off of that left hand of Smith. It was very close.
And
but this also gives an opportunity for both teams to catch their breath, and Slauson for sure. I mean, how the number of minutes he's played at such a high level, because they've relied so much on him. This is actually a real good opportunity for Slauson right now.
Yeah, and how about Slauson? He has played the majority of this game since the halftime break with four fouls.
Yes, he has, and that's when you have a player like Slauson, who's an experienced type of guy, you understand how to play with, you know, more than three fouls, and I think that's an opportunity for Slauson just to continue to showcase just why he's such a valuable player for Furman, not only for the team, but also in the Southern Conference. This is a guy who can easily be player of the year in the Southern Conference.
And the call stands as called on the floor. It's Charleston ball. Minute 53 to go in the first overtime. Charleston with the ball and with a lead of one. Underwood inbounds to Ali. Back to Underwood. Inside 2 minutes to go in OT. And Charleston with a one-point lead. Here's Smith. And he lost it. Turns it over. Bothwell racing down the floor. And Charleston got back on D. Bothwell. Hunter trying to direct offense on the point. Bothwell into the lane. And a foul called on Charleston. A chance for Bothwell to tie, if not take the lead on this trip.
I thought that was a real smart play by Bothwell after the steal to come down. Didn't have numbers that he thought he was going to have. Pull it back out, run your offense, and ultimately it led to another foul and getting to the free throw line where Furman is now needing to convert. They've been doing a really good job of getting to the free throw line. We've talked about how important that was going to be for Furman tonight.
He has 15 points tonight, but his only field goal in the second half came on that buzzer-beating bank shot three to tie the game at 78. That was his only basket in the second half of play.
That was the golden basket for Mr. Mike Bothwell. I know he was very happy with that. You could see the joy and excitement, and almost surprise when he made that shot.
80% free throw shooter coming into this game tonight. This is for the tie, and he got it. 16 points for Mike Bothwell, ties the game at 84. This is a shot for the lead and rolls it in there. 17 points for Mike Bothwell, another lead change. Furman back in the lead by one. Minute 20 to go in OT. In the corner, Farrar off the mark on that three. Rebound, Garrison has it for Furman. And they get it into Hunter's hands. We are now at exactly 1 minute to go in OT. Furman with the ball and a lead of one. Slauson, nice move, puts it in. 33 points for Jalen Slauson. Furman by three. And a timeout taken by Pat Kelsey, and Charleston will take it as well. 42.4 seconds remaining in OT. Furman in the lead by three, 87-84. You're watching Men's College Hoops on ESPN Plus. Back here in Greenville, South Carolina, Jalen Slauson has carried this team tonight.
As you can see there, as I've talked about, just get the ball down to Slauson. Good things are happening. He's continuing to say, feed me, I want more. And he's got the energy to be able to do that. Much needed break here with the timeout by College of Charleston and Pat Kelsey to try to regroup, because I don't think that was the shot that Pat Kelsey wanted from Nick Farrar earlier there. That was only his second three-point attempt this season.
Bob Ritchie said, after the High Point victory on Tuesday night in double overtime, that was a top 10 win for him and one of his favorite wins of the season or of his career. And if his team wins this one tonight, you got to wonder where this one will rank.
I think it's going to rank above that one because of the situation of how they were down and how College Charleston was shooting so hot. And I think this is going to be
Here's the shot by Bothwell. In the final seconds of regulation, forcing up a prayer and banks it in for three to tie the game at 78 and send the game to OT.
Just great recognition by Bothwell, knowing that he had to at least get something up and was able to do that, and somehow it goes in.
And yeah, he didn't call glass, but I think Bob Ritchie will forgive him for it.
Oh yeah, hey, here in Greenville, banks are open on Friday nights for Mike Bothwell.
Absolutely. So Charleston ball down three in overtime, 87-84, 42.4 to go. Tucker inbounds, looks and finds Burnham. Ali, five, missing the shot, but he's fouled. He will shoot two with 36 seconds to go.
I'm surprised there that Ali did not go and try to just lay that in rather than distribute that there. I think that was almost, there's an aspect of, you know, being unselfish, but I think Ali should have been selfish. We've seen him hit some crazy shots as well, and I think he had an opportunity for a layup there. And I think also now you're seeing a situation where College of Charleston is really missing having John Meeks and Demetrius Underwood out there, both who have fouled out.
Babacar Fai at the line. He's from Senegal. And Coach Kelsey calls him one of the smartest freshmen he's ever coached. Very high basketball IQ. Comes to College of Charleston from NBA Academy Africa in Senegal. Only a 50% free throw shooter, so he misses the first one. We'll see what he does here. His team is down three. Garrett Heen comes into the game for Furman, replacing Conley Garrison. It's a big free throw here for Babacar Fai. A chance to cut it down to a two-point game. And he does. Two-point game. Furman has the lead and the ball. About a five-second differential between the shot clock and the game clock. Here is Bothwell, pressured, fouled by Horton. And Bothwell will head of the line to shoot two.
And I love there, if you caught that, as they're inbounding the ball, College of Charleston was trying to get in a full court press, but heads up play by Alex Hunter inbounding that ball is so quick that it didn't even allow College of Charleston to really get in that full court press that they were trying to.
Mike Bothwell at the line, 17 points, shooting two. First one is good. It's back up to a 3-point game, 27.8 to go. Ike Bothwell, 10 points in the first half. His only field goal since halftime, that buzzer-beating bank shot three to tie the game. He makes both free throws there. 19 points in the game for Bothwell. Furman by two possessions, 4-point game. Shot clock turned off, 24 seconds to go for Charleston. Here's Smith, that's a three. Running out, rebound five, back out to Smith. Catch and shoot, three, and it goes in for Smith. 24 points, a new career high for Rain Smith, and a foul called on Charleston. Hunter is fouled with 11.5 to go in a 1-point game.
Well, if we wanted to see some 3-point shooting, we've got that tonight, Brock, as you can see just how fast Rain Smith can get his shot off. And that's what I think is so impressive for him, is that his release is so fast. You don't even have hardly time to get in his face to defend it because he's up and shooting so quickly.
So Alex Hunter will go to the line, 62% free throw shooter this year. He's 1 point away from tying his career high. He set that career high last weekend against USC Upstate. First foul shot is good. He ties his career high of 24. A 2-point game, 11.5 to go. If he makes it here, does Furman foul up three? Rims it in there. New career high for Hunter, 25 points. Charleston, down
three. With
this
much time, I would not foul.
Down three is Charleston, 5 seconds to go. Five, Ali for the tie. No, put back, miss, that is it. The Furman Paladins in overtime defeat Charleston 91-88, the final.
What an experience, what an environment here in Timmins Arena for Bob Ritchie and his team to come away with the win. And it's all about being able to grind through adversity, just what Bob Ritchie preaches all the time with his team.
What a game. What an ending in regulation. And what a game